Welcome. This is Information Service Engineering. Lecture number one, Information, Natural Language and the Web. This is a little teaser in which I want to summarize what will be the content of the very first lecture. Okay, let's start. In the very first section, we will talk about how to get information, of course, from the web today. So if you have an information need, if you have a question, what you can do is, of course, type this question into a search engine and see what happens. And we will explain to you how this works and what means the search engine uses to answer your query. And you will learn for the first time also the term or the concept of a knowledge graph. We see that, of course, everything that you want to find on the web depends on the use of language. And language, of course, is rather important for communicating. So successful communication and understanding is only possible by using a common language. To make these terms clearer, we have the second section of the lecture, and there we are talking about the differences of, let's say, natural languages and artificial languages. You will see the communication process in general, and we will distinguish between, let's say, speech and text. And of course, we will ask the question, what does it mean to understand something? This is, of course, one of the most important questions, since we want also the machine, the computer, to understand natural language, which, of course, is subject of natural language processing, the very first part then also of the subsequent lectures. In the third section of the lecture, we will talk about what is information and how can information be measured. So, after we have cleared and defined what information really is, we will see that from the point or viewpoint of information theory, information means this is the reduction of uncertainty. And this, of course, means the likelihood or the probability of a specific meaning will be reduced by providing more information. So here you see there is a close interconnection between the information content and the probability of the occurrence of, let's say, a specific event. This means that your information means a specific thing. So we will define as next thing, what is the information content according to Claude Shannon. So you will see what's information content, and we will introduce the notion of entropy. And based on entropy, we will show you how you are able to compute or calculate the amount of information within a message. Okay, then we go back to the web. We will see that, of course, in the web, which is constantly growing since its beginning, it's already growing beyond all means. And there we see that, of course, this ever-growing amount of information will produce problems, or already has produced lots of problems. So the point is, without search engines, we would not get along in the web. So therefore, the next chapter is focused on search engines and especially the problems that search engines have, because search engines are far from perfect. Why is that so? Usually, this comes from the imperfection of natural languages. Natural languages often are ambiguous. It means you have one word, and this word can mean different things. On the other hand, the same thing, the same information content, can be encoded or expressed in different terms. And these two forms of ambiguity, of course, are responsible that search engines are far from perfect. Not only that, but of course, here the imperfection of natural language is one of the reasons. However, since we know this now, and since we also know what it means to understand, so understanding is correct interpretation of a message, we come to the point where we ask ourselves, how do we derive the meaning of information? And you will see that information, or the meaning of information, is dependent upon, first of all, syntax, which explains you how correct or well-formed sentences are formed from single bits of information, from single words. From semantics, which gives you a function on how to transfer or infer the meaning of complex information from simple one. And of course, the semantics, this function or mapping, This is dependent on the context, which is additional information, either in the text that you are interpreting, or let's say in the context of the sender or the receiver. If you are in different social context, if you are living in different cultural context, then of course the same sentence, the same utterance can have complete different meanings. Another thing is pragmatics, which stands for the intention of the speaker. You can say exactly the same words in completely different ways and convey by that different kind of meanings. So this is then pragmatics. And of course, all of that also depends on the experience of both of sender and receiver. In your communication model, what you always do is you transfer some information encoded in a message from a sender to a receiver, and the receiver then decodes the message. And this encoding and decoding on both sides is highly important on the experience of both. And this is the individual experience. If the experience of both sender and receiver don't overlap, if you don't have a common intersection, it is most unlikely that you really will understand each other, and that in the end we can have something like a, let's say, successful communication. Okay, if you want to find out more, just watch the first lecture.